home, Shea Stadium. You sound like you're half asleep. Come on, let's hear you. How you doing? It's good to see a few people who aren't worried about a bit of rain. You ain't worried about no rain, are you? Rain's a load of rubbish. Don't worry about rain. Anyway, what we got for you tonight is we ain't got no baseball. No baseball tonight. We ain't got no football. They're on strike. But what we have got for you is a little bit of what's going on in London at the moment. So will you welcome, all the way from Ladbroke Grove, London W10, The Clash! Come on!
Now, does that kind of life sound interesting to you? That's what Cos used to do. Now, you weren't actually their manager, were you?
Well, I was their manager at some points. It was an interesting road with the Clash.
Yeah.
Clash by name and Clash by nature.
Yeah,
they did
pick
the right name. So there were some times when I stepped into the... what's that thing on the ship?
And onto the bridge.
And steered the ship until such time as relief arrived.
When did you first start working with them?
Well, the very first thing I did with them was a press conference for their... second LP, because a friend of mine at their record company was worried it wouldn't go off too well and they didn't know what to do. So I actually did something for them when Give Them Enough Rope came out.
Enough Rope.
And we kind of, you know, London's music scene isn't as big as people might imagine. So everyone starts to get to know each other. But I would say from before London Calling came out, there was a period like a period they were getting that together.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's when I came in.
And what did you bring to them, do you think? Because they could be quite stern, and you know, Bernie Rhodes, their manager, took it all very seriously. And then you came and gave them a little bit of showbiz, I think.
Well, I think what I gave to them was the appetite to... Well, maybe they had the appetite, but the will to go for it. Because I thought the Clash is the best band of its type.
Yeah.
Very different group to the Blockheads, very different. And I just believed this could be the biggest rock and roll band in the world, and they weren't. And so why don't we knuckle down and get into that position? Yeah. Go for it.
Yeah.
And I think I brought that sense of challenge and the sense that certain things have to be done a certain way, certain attitudes have to be adapted, certain goals have to be set and met. You can't just be... It's no good just being the biggest thing at the bottom end of the King's Road, you know? That's not the world.
And so you did take the Clash along. There you were at Shea Stadium doing that. You seem to be having the time of your life.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
What, a bloke with a big mouth like me standing in front of 60,000 people and I'm the only one with a microphone? Got to love that! Fantastic!
I kind of know how you feel. But they went through that period where the Clash were the biggest band in the world and everything, and then all of a sudden you seemed to disappear. You were gone. Last time I saw you, you were out of your mind in the Hammersmith Odeon. I've got to say that. And I thought, that's not... Because you used to be very, very controlled. You didn't drink much. You was really focused. Did it all kind of unravel for a bit?
I don't know if unravel's the right word. I reached a point definitely where I'd had enough. And then, you know, it's not as easy, like any kind of relationship, it's not as easy to get out of something once you've got in it, whether it be with a partner.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Or whatever.
You've had enough of the music game?
I'd had enough. I was a spent force, and I was still doing it.
Are there any stories you could tell now? So that's one of the oddest things that ever happened to you. With the Clash and stuff, was it different travelling in the South? Were there moments, if you had to look back like an old warrior looking back at the rock and roll years and think, that's an odd story. Did you ever feel threatened or were you abandoned anywhere? What is the quintessential Clash moment for you?
The quintessential Clash moment... It's really hard to pick one, but I remember we were in a recording studio in Kingston, Jamaica, in Trenchtown, Channel 1.
That's enough already.
And I think the price of a human life then, inside Trenchtown, I think you could get somebody shot for $10.
Oh, Lord.
And
man alive.
We had an argument over money, and Mikey Dredd said to me, "We got to go. We've got to go now." And of course, I'm like, "What do you mean we've got to go?" And he said to me, "Gunman business."
Oh, no.
So
Man, no wonder.
Out of Trenchtown.
That'll be the moment.
Out of Trenchtown. The funny thing about it was, about a week later when everyone had gone, I had to go back to Trenchtown and settle the bill. And I'm sitting on this motor, and there aren't even that many motors outside of this studio. And Mikey and this guy, who was like an ex-cop, I think they called him Trinity after the Spaghetti Western guy. And Mikey said, we need Trinity, he's expensive, but we need him. He's been shot more than anybody else. And, they feel like they can't kill him, so we'll have Trinity with us and they won't mess with us. And I remember sitting on this motor thinking, Trenchtown, killed on the bonnet of a car in Trenchtown.
That's
how the story's going to end.
No, do you know what? How very different from our own dear X Factor these days. But this is the life of Kosmo Vinyl. We'll come to your art in a second, my friend. So the Scorsese films, your affection and I think your heart, despite the clash and everything, was Liars with the Blockheads and Dury. Do you still stay in touch with the band?
Well, I'm going to actually see Jemima on Monday. Installed their Jemima, mm-hmm. and then I have my art show, mm-hmm. Which starts next Tuesday
in Hoxton. This we've got to approach from a different angle because it's heavily based on an East London football team that I may not care for, but we'll get to that in one second.
I'll see them then. And what I'm saying is, I'll see some of them. It depends, what people are up to. But, we try to stay in touch.
Yeah.
I stay in touch with Mick and Paul from The Clash a lot. I was with Mick yesterday.
You don't sound like a fellow who's lived in New York for 30 years. Let me say that to you.
This is the second time I've been dug out about my Brooklyn accent since I've been here.
You don't sound good. Exactly.
I know. I don't.
How do they?
I don't impress you with my Madison Avenue swagger and my mid-Atlantic twang.
How do they take to you in New York? I mean, do they think you're a lunatic?
Well, I've been one of those people, and I guess this has happened to me throughout my life, is that you go anywhere and they like check the till and the security bloke's drilling his eyeballs in your back. And I even had to say to my kids, well, you'll have to do this bit because for some reason they seem to think there's something wrong with Dad. I've just got used to it, you know?
Well, you still look pretty much the same, unlike many of us from that period, as you always did. You're always very stylish, used to always wear kind of D-mob suits. First fella I ever saw in Hawaiian shirt.
Talking about that, Paul has sent in a message saying, I remember meeting Kosmo at a Clash gig and being so impressed by his lilac suit.
Gotta say, and I can't underline it too much, from that period, if you're in any way interested in that period, Kosmo was larger and more starry and more fun than anyone else in any group, whatever you would have been. Sex Pistols, forget it. Kosmo
Can I
Vinyl.
Just say on that Shea Stadium thing, I still remember. Pink suit, pearl grey shirt, wide brim fedora, light grey, pink hat band, and I had some black creepers with pink stitching. I looked wicked.
That says more about Kosmo than anything. Now, these days, and when I first heard you're an artist, because we lost touch with each other, and I thought, oh, of course he's an artist. So am I. But it turns out you are, and your stuff is extraordinary, and it's football-based, and I won't bring any prejudice to this. It's called, the exhibition is called Is Saich Your Daddy? I could bluff it and say, what on earth does that mean, Kosmo?
Is Saich Your Daddy? I believe, let me first of all say that this was a piece of, the word is graffito. I've been educated.
Graffito.
Which I understand is when they used to do graffiti with a paintbrush before they had spray cans.
I got you.
George Davis is innocent.
Yes, okay.
There used to be a piece of this graffito written by the district line. And I think maybe there's a listener or a tweeter, who knows.
Okay.
I think it was on the wall by that very dangerous looking canal thing. When you leave Bromley by Bow Station and before you get into West Ham, I think it was right there.
This is very specific. Even I don't know where that is, but...
Right. Anyway, it was about 2 foot high. Is Saich your daddy? And we always began on the tube to the game. We'd be like, what does that... Nobody knew. Nobody had any idea whatsoever.
It's spelled S-A-I-T-H. S-A-I-T-H.
S-A-I-T-C-H. We still can't spell either of us.
Saich. Is Saich. And did you find out what it means?
I don't know what Saich means, but a funny thing happened was I let Jemima know I have a blog on which the art appears first before it goes on the walls.
And where can we see that? Where can you see that? What's the name of your blog?
Is Saich Your Daddy. That's the name of the blog.
All right.
So I let Jemima know about this. She's not a football girl, so I didn't bother to tell her for quite a while. So I told her about it, and she looked it up, and she sent me a nice email. It looks terrific. I love it. And then she sent me back an email about 4 days later, and she said, what is this weird language you and my old man speak? And I said, what do you mean? And she sent me an attachment. And in Ian Dury's handwriting on this piece of paper, it says, is Sage
no.
a daddy?
Oh.
So he's remembered it as a daddy, and I've remembered daddy. It as your daddy, which I changed to your because I thought someone might have nicked
now,
it.
And here's the twist to it. Here you are, what is it? So, you know, 3,000 odd miles away from home.
3,473.
That's exactly right. That's what I was going to say. And you still absolute through and through a West Ham supporter, and this exhibition tries to marry the two, and it's brilliantly realised. Tell everyone exactly what it is.
Well, what I do is I follow the game, I follow all the games, obviously, and then I make a visual representation, if you like, of my feeling about what has occurred. And so I put the result and basically my take or my review. And rather than write, you know, oh, the left back needs hanging or whatever it is. No, I don't, no specific left back, Hammers, don't panic. I try to do it visually.
Yeah.
So paint, images, letters, whatever's laying
they
around.
Really, and it's a terrific idea. I mean, away from my distaste for the team, I actually thought, started leafing through this, I thought, what a great idea. Like, I've got here Portsmouth nil, West Ham 1. We got what we came for, now let's get back up the A3 sharpish. It's written on it, but behind it is a wonderful kind of cocktail party going on, and you just take a gut reaction to the scores
you get. That's exactly what it is. It's a gut reaction. You know, you can't plan it before because
concept.
You don't know how the game's going to go, yeah. You know? I'd like to think that on Sunday night I'm going to be tearing up a picture of the Beatles into little pieces and writing, ha, 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 ha. But it's probably going to be somebody crying.
Yeah, well, it's, we go to the website, you can see them, and where is the exhibition on it?
The exhibition is in Oxton.
In London, OK.
In London.
Mm-hmm.
Ebb and Flow Gallery. That's 1B in Ebb and Flow. And you can look it up online if you're not in London. You just want to see what's going on.
Well, if you want to see Kosmo, you can go to 03030 as well. See, and he looks exactly the same still, where he's street scum in a Martin Scorsese film, King of Comedy, one of the great films. Also, you're on the back of Do It Yourself, lining up, I believe, in a sailor's hat with everyone else, and Fred Rowe being there. So you can see what this fella looks like and where the energy comes from. And I must say, one of the few times I've ever been on Top of the Pops was with the Blockheads doing Rhythm Stick. You can see me down in the corner of that as well. It was a terrific period. We've only just given a flavour of the phenomena that is Kosmo Vinyl. And believe me, this is not just two old mates talking. It is someone who pretty much shaped one of the most influential eras in...